everybody. Welcome to the Abroaders Travel Podcast, your weekly meetup with thousands of entrepreneurs, hustlers, creators, nomads, ninjas, wanderers, and world changers, all seeking to build the skills and connections to live a life without borders. If you want to learn more about what we do or download our entire podcast archive, check out the website, abroaders.com. Happy Wednesday morning, and welcome to another episode of the Abroaders Podcast. I'm Eric, checking in from Austin, Texas. Today is September 27th, 2017, and this is episode 190. All right, so I'm going to be doing today's show solo. A shout out to AJ, who's currently in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. He is competing for a spot for Abroaders in the startup boot camp. We made the second to the final round here. So AJ traveled out to Amsterdam last week, and he's going to be presenting to the startup boot camp folks and hopefully getting us into the accelerator program out there in the Netherlands. So really excited about that, and I'm sure he'll have some interesting stuff to share on next week's show. For today, we are going to go through some news and updates. Relatively slow news week this week, but I do have a couple of card-related things to share and a couple of benefits. So I'll cover the top news for this week, and then I'm going to break down what I thought was a pretty interesting blog post on British Airways Avios. This is also relevant for the news because we just got a heads up that it looks like in the next couple of days, the British Airways Visa card issued by Chase may be having a change in the sign-up bonus. Don't know what that means exactly. It's one of those scenarios where we don't have very much information coming from Chase, but there was an email that went out just recently saying that that bonus may be changing on the 30th. So you got a couple of days to take action. Just a quick reminder, this is 100,000 point sign-up bonus, but only if you have a huge amount of spend. However, this tiered bonus is still a pretty good deal, even if you just go for the reasonable amount of spend and get 50,000 points. So the first level of the sign-up bonus is 50,000 points after spending $3,000 in the first 90 days. And then there's an opportunity to earn an additional 25,000 points for 10,000 in spend within the first year, or 50,000 points by spending 20,000 total within the first year. So again, the higher level of the signup bonus is probably not for everybody, but this card is also unique because it's not subject to Chase's 524 rule, which means that if you have applied for five or more cards in the last 2 years, you would still be eligible for this signup bonus. Basically, the only rule around this one is you can't currently have a version of that card open, and you can't have received the signup bonus in the last 2 years. So if you're clear on those two things, you should be good to get this bonus. This is one that I'm sort of considering. I got this card like 3 or 4 years ago, and so I would be eligible to get the bonus again. It's something I'm thinking about and may take a shot at before this bonus goes away. But again, in the core content today, I'm going to go through some really interesting stuff about how you can take advantage of Avios points. But just be aware that this bonus is probably going away in a couple of days. So if you want to get on it, now is probably the time to do so. Speaking of offers ending, the next piece of news is that the Barclays Arrival Plus card, which previously had a 50,000 point signup bonus, is now down to 40,000 points. So there's still a decent offer here, 40,000 points after 3,000 spend. But that offer that used to be 50,000 is gone. So for most people, I would say this is probably a card to wait on and see if we can get it back to the 50,000 point level. We've seen this go up a couple of times a year and spend a little bit of time at the 50,000 point mark. So if you haven't gotten this card already, it's probably one to hold off on. And because we lost this card, I wanted to mention a new card from Bank of America that effectively is more or less the same thing in terms of the value that you're going to get as the Barclays Arrival Plus card. So this is the Bank of America Premium Rewards card. And this is like a straight cashback style card where you earn points that can be redeemed for a statement credit or can cancel out points for travel. But it can also be redeemed just for cash cash. So this is not tied to booking travel like the Barclays Arrival card. So the terms on this one are that you get a 50,000 point signup bonus after spending $3,000 in the first 90 days. So similar on that front. And the nice thing with this is, unlike the Barclays Arrival card, you can make redemptions for as little as 2,500 points. In other words, $25. Whereas the Barclays Arrival card, the minimum redemption value is $100 worth of travel. So if you book a $80 plane ticket, you can't use the Barclays points. So this card has a $95 annual fee. It's not waived for the first year. It probably could make sense for some folks. The nice thing about this one is the simplicity. So this is a card that if you are booking a flight, especially a flight that's difficult to book with the traditional frequent flyer miles, maybe you've got an award ticket search that isn't going very well. This is also potentially really good for regions that are hard to book award travel, like Australia, New Zealand, and sometimes parts of Africa can be really tricky to find award availability the traditional way. So this bonus is worth $500 if you get the 50,000 points, and you can just buy a plane ticket the normal way and get $500 off. The other nice thing about this one is it comes with an annual $100 airline credit. So this is intended to be used for things like seat upgrades, baggage fees, lounge fees, and things like that. We don't have any information yet if you can actually use this $100 airline credit to buy gift cards. So this would go sort of in parallel with the Amex Platinum card, where you get a $200 credit that's supposed to be for things like baggage fees and upgrades and stuff like that. But you're actually able to use that credit to cover gift cards, which you can then use to buy flights, which is sort of against what the Amex Platinum card credit is designed for. And so we don't have that information yet. If any folks do get this card, I'd love to hear back on whether buying a gift card is going to work out. But that, if you use that benefit, should be able to cancel out your annual fee. And then the other thing is that this card comes with a global entry or pre-check credit. So you can get up to $100 once every 4 years for global entry. And so that right there makes this a pretty compelling offer. Again, if you're just getting started, I would definitely focus on some of the other points and miles cards. But this one as a cashback card, or if you're in a situation where you've got a lot of the cards from Citi, Chase, and Amex, this card issued by Bank of America, it's brand new. And as far as we know, there aren't any real application rules as far as who's eligible for the bonus. So if you don't already have the bonus on this one, you should be able to get it and get $500 towards travel, or just $500 to put in your bank account. Last piece of card-related news is that the Amex Platinum card has just added a new benefit for Platinum and Centurion card members. So previously, the Amex Platinum card allowed access to a whole bunch of lounges through the Priority Pass Select program, and they also offer access to Delta lounges when you're flying Delta the same day. So if you have a Delta ticket, you can get into Delta lounges with the Amex Platinum card. And then, of course, the Centurion lounges, which there's about six or seven of them now in the U.S. and are super nice lounges. So this is not going to be useful for everybody, but Amex has just announced that in addition to those other lounges, they now are allowing access to Lufthansa lounges at the Munich airport. So this is going to be not useful for everybody, but there are two Senator lounges and two business lounges at the Munich airport that are now accessible with the Platinum card. And if you do happen to have the Centurion card, which is super expensive and not for most people, but if you have the Centurion card, that is going to give you access to Munich's first class Lufthansa lounge as well. So always nice to see those benefits getting tacked onto the card, and something that certainly is worth taking note of if you're passing through Munich. One quick reminder about lounge access. If you don't have it already, I would definitely check out the Lounge Buddy app. It's totally free, and Lounge Buddy gives you a really good breakdown of which
lounges you have access to. You add which credit cards you have and your itinerary for the day, and it does all the math and all the calculations for you to let you know which lounge you can get access to. We also have a promo code. If you use the promo code Abroaders, you get $10 off the lounge. We don't get anything for that, but if you don't have access, you can buy access through the Lounge Buddy app. So that should give you a little bit of a boost there. It's a super valuable, really useful app, so I definitely recommend checking it out. Last piece of news this week is that Citibank has just agreed to settle a class action lawsuit about the valuation of American Airlines miles that were given away to folks that opened Citi checking accounts. For a little bit of context, when you earn a sign-up bonus through a credit card, for tax purposes, sign-up bonuses are treated like a rebate on your spending. So in other words, because you have to spend a few thousand dollars to earn your sign-up bonus, you don't have to declare the value of your points for taxes. The IRS has just basically said that they're not going to tax points that are awarded with credit card sign-up bonuses as income. However, a lot of different banks have experimented in the past with offering bonus points for opening a checking or savings account. And so this is something that Citi's been doing for quite some time. And in the past, some of those bonuses for opening an account have been pretty lucrative. When you earn points this way, the bank is required to issue you a 1099 for taxes. And so this class action lawsuit is about Citi basically overstating the value of their miles. They valued the miles at 2.5 cents per mile, which actually is a pretty good number if you use miles well. But there's really no guaranteed value, and it depends a lot on how you use the points. So Citi has basically, without admitting that they did anything wrong, has agreed to pay back $1.75 million to members of this class action suit. So if you received a 1099 from Citibank as a result of opening a bank account and earning American Airlines miles, and you had a 1099 that valued those miles at 2.5 cents per mile, and this happened sometime between January 1st of 2009 and July 13th of this year, you are eligible as a class action member, and it could be worth up to $245 by participating in the class action. So we will have a link in the show notes. If you want to participate, you need to do so by November 27th of this year, and we've got a link for you to get started and register as part of the class action lawsuit. All right, so time for the core content for today. I want to share five things that you should know about British Airways Avios. Hat tip to the points guy and their staff writer, Richard Kerr. There's some pretty awesome tips in this blog post. We'll share a link in the show notes that has some of this information, but I actually learned a couple of new things here that explain a lot about how different award flights were pricing out. So we did cover British Airways Avios 2 weeks ago. We talked a little bit about how to use BA Avios, so I'm going to try not to cover the same stuff there, but that's episode 188 if you want to check that out. A little bit more detail and an example booking on a flight that we set up for AJ from Brazil back to the US. So for today, we're going to start out with number one, different award charts can mean big price differences with British Airways. So this was one of the things that I didn't really understand exactly how this was working. So BA has a distance-based chart, and every time you connect or every time you stop at another airport, they recalculate and charge a separate price for the ticket. And so the piece that I didn't really understand how the pricing was working is that British Airways has three separate charts. So they've got a chart for British Airways flights, and I believe the BA flight chart also includes Iberia flights. And one of the nice things about this one is that if you are traveling on flights operated just by British Airways or just by Iberia, you've got access to off-peak flights for certain dates out of the year. So instead of the normal pricing, which is their peak pricing, there's a slight discount if you're traveling at relatively lower season. So that's one really big benefit. The second award chart is for a itinerary that's operated by a single partner. And so these prices are like if you are flying only on American Airlines or if you're flying only on Alaska Airlines, you're basically getting a discount compared to the prices that you'd pay if you're using multiple different British Airways partners. Now, again, BA is part of Oneworld, so they've got a ton of different airlines that you can book flights on. And so the big takeaway here is that if you can organize your travel in a way that you can fly with the same airline for a full part of your trip, so for a full direction of travel, you're potentially going to save some big points. And so just to illustrate this, I want to just take an example from the post. So traveling from Narita, Tokyo to Kuala Lumpur as your transit point and then onward to Singapore, if you book that flight all on Malaysia Airlines in economy, you're going to pay 24,500 Avios points and about $23 in taxes. If you book the same itinerary, Tokyo to Kuala Lumpur and then onward to Singapore, but one of the flights is operated by Japan Airlines and the other flight is operated by Malaysia, you're going to pay 35,000 Avios and about $40 in taxes and fees. And so the only difference here, this is obviously the exact same routing, so this means that you are traveling the same distance, the same two segments that should be pricing the same way. However, they're using different award charts. And so, you know, this was something that I had seen lots of different times and just wasn't 100% clear as to why the flights were pricing this way. So it makes a lot more sense now. And hopefully that can help you organize your search. And if you do have multiple options and you're able to combine so that you're flying just on one carrier, potentially can save you quite a few points. Like I said, 10,000 points in economy, and that price difference just increases as you move up into higher classes of service like premium economy or business class. Tip number two is how to avoid phantom award availability. So one of the things that happens with British Airways that can be super frustrating is that if you search for a flight from an origin to a destination and it's not a direct flight, a lot of times when they're looking at partner award space for connecting itineraries, British Airways site is going to show you award seats that are not actually available to book. And that can be especially problematic if you're thinking about transferring points from Amex or Chase or one of the transferable currencies over to British Airways. So one solution to this is to use the Qantas website. You do have to have a frequent flyer account with Qantas to be able to log in and search for award availability, but it's a really nice option because Qantas' site allows you to search for an entire calendar of dates. So instead of just one by one, you can see a full calendar, and Qantas does a much better job at showing you flights that are actually available to book. So I'd recommend checking Qantas before you actually transfer any points. The other solution is also to just search flight by flight. So if you're looking at British Airways and you're traveling from, let's say, Madrid, and you're going to connect in London and then continue on to New York, you should be able to get the correct award availability if you search Madrid to London and then London to New York separately. So the big problem with the phantom award space is when it happens when you're trying to just search from Madrid to New York and it pulls up that option, sometimes it's not actually going to be available. All right, so tip number three is about avoiding the carrier-imposed surcharges. So this is the nasty fuel surcharges that really increase the cost in taxes and fees that you're going to pay out of pocket when using Avios points. So one of the ones that we've talked about a lot that most folks already know is that you want to avoid flying on British Airways for flights operated across the Atlantic, especially flights departing from the UK. They have a lot higher taxes, and they also will typically tack on somewhere between $200 and $400 in fuel surcharges. So if you are flying across the Atlantic, one of the best ways to do so is booking on a flight operated by American Airlines when you're flying to Europe. And this is a new one for me, flying Iberia on the way back from Europe. Now, I've done this a couple of times. American Airlines also is relatively low on the taxes and fees flying from Europe to the US. But Iberia back from Europe is coming out quite a bit below American Airlines in terms of the taxes and fees. If you're booking travel to Asia, most of the oneworld carriers from Asia don't impose very big fuel surcharges. Typically, it's going to be less than $100. So trans-Pacific flights with Avios points are a really good place to spend them. I would recommend for sure Cathay Pacific and Japan Airlines. Both have really nice products. Even in economy, it's a much better flight than it would be on an American-operated flight. And taxes and fuel surcharges are relatively low. And then for the Middle East, you've got Royal Jordanian and Qatar Airways are BA partners. Both of them are going to impose $200 or more dollars in surcharges on long-haul routes, but depending on your flight options, it could be a really nice option and might be quite a bit cheaper. If you are traveling to the Middle East or connecting to Africa or Asia, it might be a bit cheaper than going through London. So that's a nice alternative depending on where your final destination is. So tip number four is that British Airways has no close-in ticketing fees. And so when you're comparing flights that are less than 21 days before departure, British Airways can save you quite a bit of money compared to American Airlines, which is typically the type of points that most folks have that can book the same flights on oneworld airlines. So American charges a $75 fee if you're booking a flight under 21 days from departure, and BA does not have that fee. The other thing that's really nice is that American and most of the US programs have cancellation fees that are $150 to $200, and the British Airways fee is just $55 to be able to redeposit your points. So that can be a really good value. It's just especially nice if you've got British Airways and you have that option to book with them instead of with American once you're close into departure. And also knowing that once you've confirmed your ticket, you can get some of that, get those points back by canceling the ticket and paying a much more reasonable fee. Tip number five for British Airways is to take a look at flights from the west coast of the United States to Hawaii. So Hawaii, for most region-based charts, is part of a separate region from the rest of the continental U.S. Obviously, it's pretty far away. It's going to be like a 4 or 5, 6 hour flight. And so when you book with Avios, because they have a distance-based award chart, you can fly round trip from Los Angeles or Phoenix, Portland, Sacramento, Seattle, and get to Hawaii and just pay 25,000 points round trip. All right, so there you have it. Top five tips for using British Airways Avios. I hope that was helpful. Thanks a bunch for being with me for this week's show. I will see you guys next week.
Hey, Broaders, don't be shy. Hop over to the website and join our email list for exclusive travel hacking content. If you like what we're up to, the best way you can support the show is by leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes. Lastly, we would love to hear from you, so send your show feedback to Eric or AJ at Abroad.